And then making it here in the morning, on the roads, to be honest with you. But you have a reasonably good, in fact, such a good chance that you can go in there with some measure of impunity, although having said that, the guy who flies for the first time might really not share that confidence, and he's clinging on with white knuckles to the grip of the seat until the thing takes off, and then when it lands. The guy next to him is perfectly confident, hardly even looks out the window. But the interesting thing is, it's a question not of how much faith you have, but in what you're putting your faith in. You see, the man who has little faith and the man who has a great deal of faith have this in common in that case. They put their faith in the same thing. And in that case, it was a warranted faith. It brought them safely to the other side. And that is the issue. It's not how much confidence you have, but what you're putting it in. And this becomes a transfer of trust, ultimately. And when I speak about the good news of Christ, I always speak about how one has to reach the point where they abandon, let go of their trust and their hope in their own merit and their own efforts and their own works. Letting go of that is a scary thing because we've clung to that so long. And instead to transfer your trust to Christ's work on your behalf and His power and His merit. And that moment, then, is a kind of letting go of one trapeze and leaping in the air and going to the other. Or letting go as you're going off the cliff. Or getting on an airplane that you've never flown before. Or any number of analogies of faith. And again, the issue is faith is only as good as the object in which it's placed. Everybody in this room lives by faith. The fact that you drove here proves it. You put your faith in a lot of things, if you analyze it, including other drivers, expecting that they weren't going to suddenly swing into your lane. So the fact is, we all live by faith, but we also understand that that faith is only as good as the object in which it is based. And here, we have been given solid evidence that this is, in fact, a reasonable hope. This is a hope that is warranted. I have a book that I call Faith Has Its Reasons, and it's an apologetics textbook. You might not want to look at, don't get that book probably, because it's 600 pages and it's not an easy read, but I have easier books. But that one, read 20 Compelling Evidences or God, I'm glad you asked, but that one is, if you want more, if you're abusive to yourself, then you can read that book if you want. But the point that I'm saying in the title, Faith Has Its Reasons, is that this is a reasonable faith. It's a faith founded on fact. It is not just total subjectivity. And God knows that we need something that really satisfies the mind as well as fills the heart. It is wise and well for us to have a clear mind and a warm heart. You want the two to mesh together. I've looked back over the years and I've discovered that approximately half of my mind, my books rather, emphasize the mind, and about half of them emphasize the heart. The ones that emphasize the mind would be along the lines of apologetics, theology, biblical studies, psychology, things like that. And those that emphasize the heart are more in the area of spiritual formation resources, devotional tools, and those kinds of things. And I didn't do this deliberately, but I realized that actually part of what I feel my own mission is to meld and blend the mind and heart in a way that is meaningful and relevant. In fact, we have my Reflections teaching letter, which I think you're getting, many of you at least, says on the bottom, it's a teaching letter to encourage believers to develop a clear mind and a warm heart. So that's what I'm shooting for, is to, if you can put those two together, that's where you want to be. The heart cannot rejoice in what the mind rejects. And so we're going to take risks. Just make sure you're putting it in the right place. But life will always be risk-taking, and too many people that you and I know have put their hope in something that will ultimately let them down. I feel, for example, that in difficult economic times, people tend to look for some kind of savior. And as far as I can tell, the basic options that they might have before them could be God or government at the end of the day. If your temptation will be, if you're not putting your hope in the living God, you probably will hope you put your hope in something else. And it will probably, especially in difficult times, be something along that line. In fact, it's very easy to be tempted to give up some of our freedoms by the seductive offer of personal peace and affluence. Francis Schaeffer talked about that back in the late 60s, the whole idea of personal peace and affluence. And he argued, and it's demonstrable throughout the pages of history, that people have often sacrificed those things in order to get what they perceive to be a promise of personal peace and affluence. They've been willing to sacrifice certain freedoms to acquire that. And I think that that's a very interesting thing. It can lead to some real problems. I'd like you to look at Genesis 47, for example. There's an illustration of how this happens. It's called the famine. I call it the famine syndrome in Genesis 47. I'm just reading this again in my Bible reading and struck again about Joseph, as you remember, going into Egypt, predicting the two dreams that Pharaoh had, and into saying that the reason why he had two is that the matter is certain, and that both are the same, they're one and the same dream, that there will be 7 years of abundance followed by 7 years of famine. And then he wisely tells Pharaoh, here's what you need to do, and you need to find somebody who has wisdom and collect the grain and the resources that you will acquire in those 7 years so that they will sustain you in the years of famine. Here's what happens then in Genesis 47, verse 13. Now there was no food in all the land because the famine was very severe. So the land of Egypt and the land of Canaan languished because of the famine. Joseph gathered all the money that was found in the land of Egypt and in the land of Canaan for the grain which they bought. And Joseph brought the money into Pharaoh's house. So Joseph had already put these things into huge amounts of storage houses all over Egypt. And here's what happened. When the money was all spent in the land of Egypt and in the land of Canaan, the Egyptians came to Joseph and said, give us food, for why should we die in your presence? For our money is gone. So that was the first stage then. Second stage is, give up your livestock, and I'll give you food for your livestock since your money is gone. So they brought their livestock to Joseph, and Joseph gave them food in exchange for the horses and the flocks and the herds and the donkeys. And he fed them with food in exchange for all their livestock that year. When that year was ended, they came to him the next year and said to him, we will not hide from my lord that our money is all spent, and the cattle are my lord's. There is nothing left for my lord except our bodies and our lands. But why should we die before your eyes, both we and our land? Buy us and our land for food, and we and our land will be slaves to Pharaoh. So give us seed so that we may live and not die, so that the land may not be desolate. So Joseph bought all the land of Egypt for Pharaoh, for every Egyptian sold his field because the famine was severe upon them. Thus the land became Pharaoh's. Interesting thing in that process. They call it the famine syndrome. It had four stages. First of all, they exchanged their money. When they were out of money, then it was secondly the livestock. And then third, after that, it was their land. And finally themselves, where they went into slavery. And I think that this is illustrative of a process that has occurred more than once in history, many times in history. The danger is, for example, for us to move from, in our own country, I fear, from a free market society to a social market economy. And I think that's a very real possibility with diminished freedoms. Surely when sources of credit disappear and when they lose their resources, you're going to be having to feed off existing assets, which can lead to increasing dependence. The question, if these things occur, and only God knows where things are heading, the question's going to be, what will you put your hope in if times get tougher than they currently are? You know, we do not know where things are heading. We cannot predict that. Experts radically disagree with each other. It fascinates me how that is. And by the way, if you read Taleb's book, The Black Swan, you'll see